Berks Perspectives on BCTV is supported by a friend of BCTV.
Greetings and welcome to another edition of Berks Perspectives. I'm Chuck Gallagher, and with me on this bright spring day, finally, with the sun shining, we have sunshine here in the studio in the presence of Mr. John Forrester.
Good afternoon.
Fred Levering.
I feel like I need sunglasses sitting next to him.
Ruth Martelli, who radiates every day, regardless of the sun.
Yes.
And of course, evermore, Fred Opalinski.
Evermore. Hi, Chuck.
Indeed. Welcome. We got some things to kick around locally. The Kernsville Dam, the safety up that issue has been the rock. People drowning almost on a too regular basis because they want to go swimming in the river. When they take the Kernsville Dam down, that rock swimming pool will go away. And I think that's a step toward it because they're not ignoring they have been ignoring the trespassing signs and what have you.
Yeah. Well, it makes sense. I mean, it's a nuisance. It's a liability. On the other hand, you got to somewhat feel lost to, you know, the idea of taking all the dams out. And I understand environmentally why and stuff, but I think about out on the river near here in Muhlenberg, where the Felix Dam was not fixed, and there were a lot of people that have a lot of nice memories of going out there boating and sitting at bungalows having barbecues and whatnot, and all that went away, which, you know, you can't help but feel that the area lost something with that, but I get it.
Well, go ahead.
As I recall, the Kernsville Dam was built about the same time as Blue Marsh, and it was for flood control.
So, right, exactly.
So I don't know.
Yeah, it was never a recreation area. That's right.
No.
Yeah.
Maybe a recreation area downstream here near the city would be a viable step for the city to show a little.
Well, we've talked about it many times.
Right.
Most cities that redevelop themselves take advantage of waterfront. And so far, we haven't done much.
Tough waterfront to take charge of, I guess. Again, on the safety patrol, the roundabout at Roots 662 and 222 is opened, and it seems to have gone moderately safely. This is what, one of five that are planned?
Yes, yeah, plus a pretty big intersection improvement at 73. So there's a lot of work underway, and I had trepidation when I heard about opening it partially. It's supposed to be two lanes when it's finished, and it's only one lane open as they continue work. And that made me nervous because there's been a lot of controversies about roundabouts and whether they work and all that usual Berks County naysayer stuff. And my fear was that they would open up partially, not have any market improvement, and then people say, see, I told you it wouldn't work. But apparently it's gone better than I feared, so hopefully it continues.
Well, if anybody who's ever traveled in Europe or New Jersey, Ireland in particular, yeah.
I was stuck in a roundabout in London going the wrong way. And I got in the very inner lane and couldn't get out.
Right.
It took me hours to get out. I thought I'd be trapped there forever.
You're like Charlie on the train in Boston.
Right.
You never return.
Well, we've had one in West Reading for a long, long time. And that seems to go well, right?
But these modern things on a highway are a lot different in how the geometry works and stuff than...
Well, but the principle's the same. Those coming on yield and those that are in there have right
away.
Well,
the whole key to them is that the traffic never stops. The problem with an intersection is the traffic light. The traffic stops, and then things back up, and then it turns green, and a few get through, and then
I think they are a great
idea.
And I'm trusting that we're going to adapt. I mean, people everywhere else adapt to it.
You will ask you, John, if he gets caught again?
Well, go the right way. In this country, it's to the right.
Yeah, I understand that.
Again, in the safety area, the city's looking at replacing two firehouses with the possibility of two more down the road. Quite an expense coming down there.
Well, it's got to happen, though. The public safety is still the most important function of government, and police and fire have to be adequate. And for modern days, I mean, it's tough. I mean, we've gone through it in our municipality with trying to keep ahead of fire service. I mean, when you're not getting enough volunteers, I mean, it can begin to affect insurance rates in your community and stuff. So how many people are turning out to a fire. There's a lot of reporting that goes with these things, and you got to keep it up to date.
Most of the fires in the city are fought now by paid firefighters. Right.
And that's the way it's going. I mean, it's not good news for municipalities that are under a lot of financial stress already, but there's just the age that we live in and people doing so many different things in their lives and both spouses working and everything else with the kids. It's volunteerism is not going to get better.
Speaking of politics, one of our local politicians has resigned from Congress and has taken a job with CNN, Mr. Charlie Dent. To me, it's an interesting step. Usually they wait until after they've been finished their 10, 20 years in Congress before they'll grab a job like that. Evidently, Charlie found it a little too inviting.
Well, looking forward, I was very sorry when he announced that he wasn't going to run again, because I think we need more people like him in Congress, for sure. But he'll do well in that.
You mean
capacity.
Republicans?
I was going to say Republicans, and I purposely didn't. But
because he is very much a moderate Republican.
Yeah, he is sensible. He's wise. He's articulate. I have admiration for him, and I'm just, as I say, we need more of those kind.
Well, I got to say one thing, though. I mean, I like Charlie. I know him, and I know Ryan Costello and like him. But the idea of deciding not to run and then stepping down before the end of the term, particularly with this turmoil of changing the maps and stuff, basically leaves constituents in both those districts without representation for the rest of this year. And that's, I don't think that's right.
Well, if I can throw a little side of the coin at you, nothing much is getting done anyway.
Yeah, but you got to keep trying, Chuck. You can't give
up. Are they trying? Is that the thing? Or are they just...
Well, I believe Charlie was. Yes.
Charlie, I'm sure, was. Yeah.
And I believe Brian
and,
as well.
And both of them have been voices in the wilderness. I mean, they just haven't been listened to. And they've had no power, really.
And they would have been attacked from the right in a primary, or
absolutely,
were they to run again.
I don't know
and
about
it would
Costello.
Have been ugly.
I don't know about Costello, but Dent surely
for sure.
would have.
And it can't be easy to realize that you are a public servant who people don't respect because you aren't far right that it's almost.
I have heard the argument.
Un-Republican.
And then this might shock you, that perhaps we aren't paying our legislators in Washington enough.
And we've gone down that road before.
And that we aren't attracting quality leaders. And
how about fewer representatives at more money, if you want to balance the budget?
Government closest to the people is the best, and you're already representing over 600,000 people.
I agree with Fred on that. How
do you pay for it then?
Well, they could double their salaries, and that would scarcely put a dent in the federal budget.
That's right.
The reality is that what the position pays, you know, and I've been involved with it, as you know, and I can't really think of anybody that ran for that position because of the salary. I mean, they're doing it because of love of government or love of power or whatever the heck it is, but it's rarely just for how many dollars I'm going to take home.
Well, the COLA in D.C. has got to be way out of sight compared to cost of living, compared to
that's why most of the people in the Congress are millionaires, or many of the people in the Congress are millionaires. We have to address the whole system, because there's something wrong when you live in what you call a democratic republic, but the only people who can afford to serve in the government are people who are independently wealthy, because they can't live on the stipend that they're paid to represent their constituents. I'm not saying that some of those people who are millionaires aren't good people. But it's almost as though, I'm sure when Fred was running, he had to really seriously think about whether or not he could actually live on that salary. Now, you already said you wouldn't have lived in D.C., you would have traveled home. Well, part of the reason that we're in the jam we're in is because nobody lives in Washington anymore. So there's no camaraderie, there's no social life where men and women in the Senate or the House of Representatives go out to dinner,
not entirely
have a
true.
Beer.
There's an awful lot of people that do live down there, whether they're in D.C. or in the suburbs, I can't tell you. But if you are serving a district in Wyoming, you're not going to go home on a weekend. I mean,
well,
that
of course
doesn't
not.
Work.
But then you have all those guys living together on K Street. And if you're hanging out and living with everybody who thinks the way you do, then how do you engage people who have different points of view? That's why we're stuck in the morass we're in, where you and I can't talk to one another, because our differences are so, I'm not saying that that's true, but that our differences are so entrenched that there's no room for dialogue.
Well, how many of you guys are living on K Street, though? I think a lot of, if you go probably past Pittsburgh is when those people are going to be staying in town. And go down south, maybe.
Many of them do go home on
and
weekends.
And they're men who spend who live literally in their offices. That's where they sleep. That's where they eat in the cafeteria.
Who was the most recent case where they found that he was in fact living out of his office? I forget. There was somebody fairly recently who was living literally out of his office. He had a refrigerator in there, and he had a change of clothes and all that. That's a devil of a way for a guy to serve the country.
That's not how Mr. Smith planned to go to Washington.
No, that's for sure. And we're dating yourself there.
I've
All of
been
us.
Dating myself for a long time.
Well, I think the founders wanted the representatives and the senators to have be well compensated for their efforts, I don't think it has kept up with it.
But John, when they wrote the document, the United States, for all intents and purposes, ended at the Appalachian Mountains.
True.
There was no way that they knew that eventually somebody would be hightailing it to Washington from Washington, Oregon, or California, or Idaho, or Wyoming. It just wasn't within the scope of what they could envision.
It could be they could vote themselves raises.
But not when you cut the funds
for people to eat who don't have money to eat.
Well,
they were also wealthy guys, the founders too. I mean, they were all landholders for the most part.
You had to be.
Yeah.
Well, there wasn't envisioned that people would become career politicians.
True.
I mean, the idea was you go back, have a little meeting,
and turn around and go home.
Right.
Speaking of having a little meeting in politics. Our president has decided to flex his biceps, evidently, because he's going after the Department of Justice and the Federal Bureau of Investigation, demanding that they acquiesce to his requests, or the requests of some of the Republican Party for information.
Well, the fact that he's put an informant into the position where that informant's name is now public knowledge, and where he's directed that only two Republican members of the Congress, House of Representatives, are being debriefed. At least that's what we were told at 12. And I guess now, 18 minutes ago, the Gang of Eight was being debriefed as well of
eight
the same
minus
information.
One. Hmm? 8-1, because Ryan's not going to be there.
Yeah, Ryan made an excuse.
Well,
he had to get a haircut, I think. No, he wasn't in the first one.
Well, I thought they included him.
Well, he said he wasn't going. He had a previous appointment.
And how, you know, can you defend that? Can you defend that behavior?
Well, I don't know what his appointment was. I have no idea.
No, I don't mean his behavior. I mean, not going for
a
haircut.
I mean, I'm pretty well informed, Ruth, but really.
I just cannot imagine that anybody in this country thinks that that's amusing.
Well, I don't think it's amusing if there were indeed plants within the campaign of somebody running for president.
There's no evidence.
But there's
of it.
No evidence.
We'll find
of
out
it.
Today.
Well,
It was a confidential source, which the FBI uses all the time, and James Clapper explained that they were not investigating the campaign; they were investigating. Or so-called collusion.
Looking for a Russian.
They were looking
influence.
Into whether there was Russian influence in the campaign, which is a crime.
But there didn't seem to be any corresponding investigation of whether anybody was doing that from the Hillary campaign.
We don't know that. And there again, this the, that's over. There has never been any suggestion that the Democratic presidential nominee was in collusion, or that there was any attempt made to influence that.
Well, Putin hated her guts. Absolutely hated her guts, because
probably still does.
He accused her of messing in his election in 2011. And so the supposition is that he was bound and determined that either he was going to prevent her from becoming president or create such a stink during the process that her presidential
credibility
would be
lost,
ruined, and her presidential run would be awful.
It seems to me that this is a part of the Trump narrative to discredit anything to do with Mueller and the investigation. It's another shiny object over here to distract us from the what's really going on. And I think he's doing perhaps irreparable harm to the Justice Department. And it's going to be a long time. I mean, because he has said over and over again, this is a witch hunt. This is a hoax. There's nothing to it.
The Democrats
And psychological studies have shown that you keep repeating things, people eventually begin to believe it. And there's, 35% of the American public that is cheering him on, believing it, and thinking that there is a deep state conspiracy and all of that.
There's a point I want to throw up. Do we want to take a look at what this deep state, dark state... The president was the man who brought, first of all, the birther thing about the previous president, and the birther. He was born. He wasn't born in this country.
That went on for years. That's one conspiracy theory after another.
Well, that's my point.
How much
conspiracy theory should we take to heart, or how much should we just? Why are we getting so much of it?
The Trump went nuts over Hillary Clinton's aides when they took the fifth and. Whatever.
He says the only people that do that are people with things to hide. Yeah.
And if he's innocent, why doesn't he just say, get on with it? I appreciate that this is your job.
The deep state.
The deep state he's referring to is the bureaucratic establishment in Washington, which is there. It's rooted. It's civil servants who are there no matter who's in power. And apparently somebody has taken umbrage at the fact that the entire bureaucracy doesn't up and quit and change with the change of administration.
Well, I agree with you that, the elected officials come and go, but the bureaucracy stays forever. We, both know that for a long time. What has changed, though, is that you used the word civil servants, and that's where it has changed. I don't think a lot of those people any longer are doing the public's business. They're there with an agenda. They have some thing that they're hot on, whatever it might be.
Well, now you're buying into
environmental things or whatever it is, and they're there. And I've seen it firsthand in Pennsylvania with working with builders in Berks County, and what they go through with mandates that come down from EPA to the Pennsylvania DEP. That are just insane. And there are people in those agencies that are no longer there working as public servants, but they're there because they are true believers.
But you're looking at those regs as a realtor. That's your bias.
I'm not just looking at it as a realtor. I'm looking at it as a Berks County.
Fred, I think
how many new homes
I think you're conflating. I think you're conflating
two things.
The officials of the various departments with the soldier ants.
No, the problem is that the people that run for governor talk a good game about how we're going to make government user-friendly, and the word never seems to get below the secretary level.
But is that part of the deep state? I mean, we're talking
about... Well, that's what it is. There is no deep state.
There's no deep state.
There is no deep state.
There can be a loyal opposition.
How was it created, and how does it continue to breathe?
But it's the ingrained, as John said, bureaucracy that's there forevermore. I mean, they're on
they're paper pushers. They are holding on to their jobs.
Right, and how can they weigh in to the point of impacting elections and impacting those kind of things?
They can't.
Well, and the thing, I mean, Trump is most highly critical of the Republican appointees that he's put into place. You know, I mean, and he maligns them daily and discredits them daily, all of it so that when the report finally comes out from Mueller's office, there will be a substantial number of people who pay no attention to it or who have already discredited it in advance, no matter what it says.
I think it's
an assault on America, really.
Whoever it was in the White House who said about John McCain, well, his vote doesn't matter because he's dying.
Yeah.
Just really crass and thoughtless, heartless things that people take for granted. I didn't hear very many Republicans at all.
Well, there were several who came out.
But nowhere in that party has anybody actually, other than Jeff Flake yesterday in his speech at Harvard, was scathing. But as somebody pointed out, he's voted with the president.
Well, how about Tillerson?
Well, what did he do except try to emasculate the State Department when
speech, he came out and he was very critical.
Yeah, but he didn't do anything when he was in office.
Well, he was working for somebody then.
But nobody stands up and says, this is not the way it's meant to be done.
Right.
Let me jump off of this, if I may, John. We had the situation with North Korea coming and the summit was going to be set up for the middle of June. We were going to go over to Singapore and meet with the North Koreans and get some resolution. Now that's been scrapped. The president just wrote a letter to Mr. Un and said, no way, we're not coming. Is that going to... It puts me in mind of the fact that the Swedes have come out publishing a 28-page booklet, Prepare for War, in Sweden. And it's out in several languages, so it would be interesting. It's a scary thought.
I think Trump, in this case, reacted to what the North Korean leadership did. I mean, they talked a good game. I think they came to the table because of pressure from the Chinese.
Probably.
And that hasn't changed. In the past, they have flip-flopped countless times on things, and they got away with it. That doesn't seem to be that they're getting away with it this time. They said, wait a minute, if that's the way you're going to be, then we're not coming.
Then where does that leave us?
Well, I think ultimately the influence of the Chinese will bring them back to the table.
We're hoping the Chinese have that influence.
Well, yeah, I'm hoping that Bolton doesn't go off half-cocked.
And have us declare war on them, too.
Okay, well, speaking of declaring war, what do we think about the NFL's response? Anybody who takes a knee during the playing of the anthem will get fired or fined.
I think it's un-American. NFL can do whatever they want in terms of writing the rules.
I think it's a business problem. They were finding that they were suffering business-wise, and so they changed
it. It's a business, but it was a business that was brought about the president making a point of saying that those SOBs should be fired.
The bottom line is the attendance at the stadium and the ratings on TV were going downwards, and that's what they wanted
but
to stop.
But I think they're going to continue going down, too, because technology now, how much do you spend to go to a football game, a pro
Too
football
much.
Game?
Too much.
Two kids... Family, maybe $140-$150.
Ouch! Not even that. I mean, more than that.
Oh, well, that's going to begin because you can sit at home and television, have a six pack and a couple of sodas and whatever else, and have a party for a whole lot less than that.
Well, actually, that's not the issue here. The issue here is, do these players have a right to express themselves under the First Amendment? And my thinking on this is that. They're employed by the owners of the teams, and if the owners want to set those conditions, they're perfectly within their rights.
And well, they'd say no facial hair, for example.
Well, that's what I said. They have the right to write the rules, but to me, it seems to be almost an oxymoron to say that you're going to force patriotism. I mean, if patriotism doesn't come from the heart, and it's their definition of patriotism, I take those people who are kneeling to be every bit as patriotic as the ones who are standing.
Well, it has nothing to do with patriotism.
On their own time.
It has nothing to do with patriotism. It's a comment.
But that's how it's being framed.
It's a social commentary.
But the Trump today said, well, whenever the anthem is played, we need to stand up straight and show that we're proud. And if you can't do that, then maybe you don't deserve to live in this country.
And he's ignoring the issue.
I think they should force people to sing it. I think that should be the requirement. If you're going to, I mean, why not?
It's like one more way to divide
us. It's about the words. It's not about listening to the music, yeah. Right?
And I think this is a good opportunity, though, to talk about this coming weekend. This is Memorial Day weekend and what we owe to the people that have been out there defending it and so on.
What we owe them is health care and treatment for PTSD.
No,
and those sacrifices
no, wait, that's veterans,
need to be.
That's veterans. This is a Memorial Day. People really confuse these. We have Armed Forces Day. We have Memorial Day. We have Veterans Day.
Memorial Day is for those who have died.
Memorial Day is for those who gave
the picnic weekend. And it really needs to be reflecting on what we owe to those people that have gone out and sacrificed mightily. To defend the right of us sitting here chewing on these things is what we owe those people.
My dad's grave every year is decorated with a flag. He never got out of the country. He was in World War I, whatever. But as important as the memory of those men and women are, it's equally as important to keep in mind those men who come home wounded in ways that would have led them to a grave 10 years ago. So if it's a conflation, I think it's a warranted one.
Well, good thoughts there, Memorial Day, to memorize that. I throw in the fact that I have a bit of a problem with making this big issue about patriotism coming from a man who actually avoided the draft.
Five times.
But I mean, I think if that were me, I wouldn't have the intestinal fortitude to come out and make an issue of it. But that's not me. That's him. So on this Memorial Day weekend, we thank you all for watching. Hope that we see you again next week. Be well.
Berks Perspectives on BCTV is supported by a friend of BCTV.